I'd like to express our thankfulness to Your Excellency Ambassador Van Drey,
Professor Neupane, Professor Karga KC, and dear friends. First of all, let me say, you know, what a great pleasure it is to be back to lecturing, if only for half an hour or 40 minutes. This is a profession that I left, I guess, since 2014. So, about 36 years ago, I started my career as a lecturer in Delhi University. Of course, at that time, I was not lecturing on international affairs since I knew nothing about the subject. But economics was my subject, and that's what I was lecturing on. And I must say that I really enjoyed my two-year stint as a lecturer at Delhi University, interacting with young people who went on to do great things. So I'm sure that all of you here who are pursuing a master's program in international affairs will hopefully work for your country, will promote the diplomacy of your country in some way or the other, not necessarily in the government, not necessarily by joining the Nepalese diplomatic service, but you know, this is a globally integrated, interdependent world. And even though we may not realize it, at every moment in time, the outside world is impacting on our lives and what we do. So I think it's very, very important to understand the dynamics of foreign policy, and especially for a country like Nepal, which is situated in the way that it is between India on one side and China on the other. I think it's very important for Nepalese scholars and Nepalese students of diplomacy to understand your neighboring countries, understand foreign policies of your neighboring countries, and see how you can actually benefit and take advantage of the opportunities that exist. Of course, I think, you know, whatever the circumstances, I think you have to develop a mindset of trying to benefit from those circumstances for your country, however difficult they may be, whether you like them or not. But if those circumstances are a fact of life, I think as diplomats, as civil servants, as citizens of the country, what is most important is for you to see how you can benefit from them. So I'm going to speak a little bit about India-Nepal relations, not in a historical context, because that you can read from the books. I want to focus more on the contemporary relationship and to make you understand where we are coming from in India, how we look at the situation in Nepal, what our foreign policy is trying to achieve in the context of Nepal-India relationships, and how I feel that is of benefit to both countries. So obviously, if you're looking at the relationship between two countries at any given point in time, you really have to first examine the situation in each of those countries, because clearly it is the domestic context which influences the external policy of any nation. And it is the domestic context in Nepal which is very important. It is the domestic context in India which is important. So in order to understand the relationship between the two countries, I think you also have to understand what's happening in your own country, what's happening in India. Because as I said earlier, things happening outside impact on your lives, and certainly things happening in neighbors have a very direct impact on your lives. So it's very important that you understand what's happening in the other countries. So, you know, the way we look at the recent contemporary developments in Nepal, I mean, I see this as a moment of great change, of great opportunity, of great moment in the context of our bilateral relationship. You know, Nepal is now nearing the end of the peace process that began officially in 2006. A lot has been achieved under this peace process, and it is now nearing its completion as and when the constitution is finally drafted and promulgated in Nepal. And while all this is happening, your country is going through multiple transitions. It's not easy, I think, for people to comprehend what's going on. So your country is going through multiple transitions, from a monarchy to a republic, from a Hindu Rashtra to a secular state, from a unitary system, unitary structure, to a federal structure. And you know, these transitions take decades, if not longer. If you look at other countries, these are not easy transitions. And many countries undergo these transitions sequentially. In your case, everything is happening in parallel. So you are undergoing these very fundamental transitions that will transform the nature of the Nepali state, of Nepali society, of Nepali government, all simultaneously. And I must say, as an outsider, when you look at the developments in Nepal, I feel very optimistic. Because, you know, it's not easy to come out of a conflict, 10-year-long conflict, thousands of people killed, a lot of suffering, and to come out of it and manage your affairs in such a way that there is a sense of great hope and optimism today. Of course, there have been fits and starts, you know, there have been positive developments, there have been negative developments as well. But in sum, when you look at the situation, I feel very optimistic that these transitions are happening in a very sustained way, and the trend movement, the trend direction is very clear. And I think a lot is to be said for that. You know, if you look at the situation in any country, at a given moment in time, you can be overwhelmed by the issues. But if you just step back a little bit and look at it with some distance, then you'll see the trend. And I think the trend in Nepal is extremely positive. And why do I say that? I think, you know, despite a lot of skepticism, you had excellent constituent assembly elections, outstanding elections. And I remember even 1 week before the elections were held, I had a lunch meeting with top editors of the newspapers here, and everyone was skeptical. They kept saying, no, we don't think elections will happen. The elections happened, excellent elections, hardly any violence. And with that, I think the political vacuum in the country has been filled with an elected government, with a duly constituted constituent assembly, which is working its way towards finalization of the constitution. Very strong political will in Nepal that the constitution must be promulgated within a year. So I think these are extremely positive developments. So this is how we look at what is happening in Nepal today. Now, what is happening in India? In India, we've also gone through our elections, and we've had a very momentous change in the politics of India. And we have a new government in power led by the BJP government. It's a government with an absolute majority, which is something that has happened in India, I think, after 30 years. You know, there was a time when everybody said that now there will only be coalition governments in India. There will not be any government with an absolute majority. So they have been proved wrong. So we have a strong government. We have a government that was actually sitting in the opposition for a long time. And we have a government which attaches the highest priority to the neighborhood in the context of its overall foreign policy. So, as a matter of principle, even before our new Prime Minister assumed office, he took the decision to invite the leaders of all SAARC countries to participate in his swearing-in, and all the leaders accepted. And I think this was a huge gesture which went down extremely well in the entire neighborhood, that here now you had a Prime Minister in India who was taking personal interest in foreign policy issues, and particularly with regard to the neighborhood, that the neighborhood would really have primacy insofar as India's foreign policy is concerned. So in a very direct way, through this invitation, I think he demonstrated that he can walk the talk, and that he sincerely believed in the importance of the neighborhood. The first visit that our Prime Minister made was to Bhutan. Our Prime Minister is also keen to come to Nepal, and I hope very much that that visit will fructify, hopefully before the SAARC summit. In any event, he will be here for the SAARC summit. Recently, when he was launching, he had gone to Sriharikota in southern India for the launch of several foreign satellites by an Indian, by ISRO, the Indian Space Research Organization. What did the Prime Minister say over there? He says, why can't we develop a SAARC satellite which will be of benefit to all the SAARC countries? So you can see in his thinking, in his mind, when he is thinking about foreign policy and things to do, he is focusing on the neighborhood. So I think this is a great opportunity. And I think hopefully we will be able to crystallize many of these neighborhood related things in the SAARC summit, which is going to happen in Nepal, which is being chaired by Nepal in November. So I think the auguries are very good. The moment is ripe. Change in Nepal, change in India, and a change which is very positive insofar as India-Nepal cooperation is concerned, India-Nepal relations is concerned, which is very positive insofar as India-SAARC relations are concerned. So I think, you know, if both countries can get their act together, then this is the time when we can actually get major decisions off the ground. But this is also the time when a lot of work requires to be done. You may have all the political will in the world, but if you haven't done enough spade work, nothing happens. So basically, it is now incumbent on all of us, especially, you know, people like me who are in the government in this profession, to really develop concrete programs and projects that can be agreed and that will carry forward the relationship. When the Prime Minister Sushil Koirala met our Prime Minister in Delhi, you know, the key focus was on economic cooperation. And when I said earlier that our government is focusing on neighborhood policy, within neighborhood policy, the most important aspect of cooperation is economic cooperation. Because I think there is a very deep sense that our region, our countries individually and collectively, have not been able to achieve their rightful role in international affairs. That our region, for some reason, has been left behind a little bit. That our region is very poor relative to what is happening in the rest of Asia. So I think there is a desire to speed up growth and development for the betterment of our peoples and the lives of our own peoples. Not only that, also to catch up with other countries and what is happening over there. So I think, you know, with this determination comes the feeling that we have to basically focus on economic development bilaterally, I mean individually and bilaterally. That is the way to become strong. That is the way to gain respect and recognition in the world, play your rightful role. So I think within the context of our neighborhood policy, you will see a huge primacy to economic cooperation. In the context of Nepal, Prime Minister Sushil Koirala, when he went to Delhi in May, had a very good meeting with Prime Minister Modi. And what was the main issue that they discussed was economic cooperation. And the view expressed by our Prime Minister was that, you know, let us choose one or two areas where there is interest in both countries, which represent a win-win situation for both countries. Let us focus on those. Let us develop a plan. Let us implement that within, say, 2 years. And actually, let us have things moving on the ground. And let the people of our countries realize that, you know, we mean business and that these projects and programs are going to be of benefit to them. And one of the areas identified was cooperation in the water resources sector or in hydropower. I'll come back to this a little later. Other areas were things like tourism, high-value agriculture, high-value service industry. So what I'm trying to say is that this is really a great moment. Such moments don't arrive very frequently in the relationship between countries, and I think this is a great opportunity for our two countries to seize the moment and actually to really benefit, to do something at this point in time which will be of great benefit to our two countries. Now, what are India's, how does India, I've already mentioned to you how we look at contemporary developments in Nepal, but what is India's objective? Or what is the objective of India's foreign policy in Nepal? See, your foreign policy objectives are obviously a determinant of the geographical situation in which you find yourself, your economic situation, the international context, a lot of factors, and I'm sure lecturers and professors more learned than I am have been talking to you about those issues. So, as two countries, as two neighboring countries with such an ancient and such a strong interlinkage, with open borders between our two countries, what is our key objective in Nepal? Key objective of India's foreign policy in Nepal is to see peace, stability, and progress. Because the opposite of this will mean huge problems for India itself. If there's instability in Nepal, if there are vulnerabilities, if there is no development, then not only Nepal will suffer, but India will also suffer. So I think the principal objective, and I'm sure this is the objective of the government of Nepal itself, is peace, stability, and development. And I'm sure this is what Nepal would like to see in India itself. So I think at a very fundamental level, there is no contradiction between the strategic objectives of the two countries. So I am one who believes that actually, you know, while there may be irritants and so on, and we can discuss those later on, but at a very fundamental strategic level, I think the objectives of both our countries converge, and there is really no difference. So how do you achieve, you know, how, it's all very well to say peace, stability, and development, but it's not easy to achieve it. So if you look at India's role in Nepal, you please look at it from this prism or this context, that, you know, anything we are trying to do in Nepal is with this fundamental and strategic objective in mind. So our actions have to be understood within this context and this framework. And being a democracy ourselves, being a parliamentary democracy ourselves, we also feel, not that we are wedded to a particular form of governance, but naturally, having a very well-established, long-standing multi-party democracy in our country, we feel that in Nepal itself, and this is really the aspiration of the people of Nepal, which we have supported, that stability and development in Nepal will take place on the basis of strongly rooted multi-party democracy in the country. And obviously then, you know, you can logically follow from all that. You know, how do you have multi-party democracy? You need a constitution. How do you ensure stability? You need an inclusive constitution which accommodates the aspirations of all the people of Nepal, all sections of society, different groups, etc. So, you know, logically you can see, you can relate virtually every aspect of at least our policy in Nepal to this fundamental objective. Now, you know, I spoke about stability. Now, just look at it the other way. If there is instability in Nepal, what are the implications for India? You know, if there is instability in Nepal, at least thanks to the open border, you don't have refugees. But if you remember Bangladesh in 71, we had closed borders, but we had 10 million refugees on our border and the crisis that led to. Nepal has gone through a huge conflict of 10 years. But because of the open border, you had a safety valve. If you did not have an open border, can you imagine what would have happened within the country? So I think, you know, this is something to reflect upon. And when I talk about if there is instability in Nepal, obviously it's going to spill over into India. If there is vulnerability in Nepal, obviously it will spill over into India. And I think all of you know about, you know, of course, smuggling and so on happens. But more dangerous than that are, you know, terrorist activities. There was the hijack of the IC-814 at one time. Or there are, you know, fake currency rackets, smuggling of gold, and stuff like that. So if you have an open border between the two countries, I think it's very necessary to have excellent security cooperation between the two countries. If you look at the Schengen countries, because Schengen states in Europe is basically an open border, but they have very, very strict controls in terms of the manner in which they are issuing visa to non-Schengen nationals, in the manner in which the outer perimeter of the Schengen geography is controlled by security forces. Because, you know, once you enter a Schengen state, you can go anywhere. So those who want to create problems will try to enter the Schengen area through the weakest Schengen state. And, you know, please don't quote me, but, you know, this was a big problem vis-a-vis Greece. When Greece was going through huge problems, a lot of people were coming in through Greece. not settling down in Greece, but then going on to other Western European countries and claiming refugee status. So obviously, if you have open borders, I mean, you cannot have open borders if you don't have security cooperation. So I think the two go together. If you have open borders, you must have very good cooperation. If you don't have open borders, then each country has to look after its security itself. So I think this is something that you all must understand. You know, a lot of debate talking about open borders, this, that, and the other. But what I'm happy to say to you is that at the policy level, at the political level, at the working level between our security forces, whether it is the SSB and the armed police force, or the, you know, our state police and the Nepal police, the intelligence agencies, excellent cooperation. I think that's the way it is to be. So what we've been trying to do is to create the legal framework within which such cooperation can take place, and B, to ensure that at the working level there is very good contact and cooperation. Now, at the legal framework, unfortunately, in Nepal this has become a huge political issue. The extradition treaty, for instance, which has been initialed, has not been able to be signed. For what reason, I you know, find it very difficult to understand. But obviously for some political reasons. So this has not been done. There is also a mutual legal assistance treaty, which we are very keen on, because since we have open borders, we have people from each other's country working in the other country. And if person A, say from India, comes to Nepal, commits a crime and, you know, goes back to India, there is no way that a court summons from Nepal can be served on the person in India, because we don't have this treaty. So I think, you know, if you look at it practically, then you'll see the relevance and the importance of this. So there are people, it's not only third country, you know, it's not only outsiders who may misuse the open border, even nationals of our own countries may misuse the open border, and, you know, because there are these lacuna in our legal arrangements, they try to benefit from it. So we must try and plug these. And I don't think there's any politics or any great conspiracy or anything involved in this. And these are practical matters that have to be addressed. So I think overall, my conviction is that the open border is a huge asset to the relationship between our two countries. Millions of people cross the border every day. There are all kinds of cultural, familial, religious, other contacts. Just 2 days ago, I was in Ilam, and I went to Pashupati Phatak. And it was so wonderful to see the relationship between the border guarding forces on the two sides. You know, I went to the SSB headquarters a little inside, and all the Nepalese escorts and policemen and everyone came in over there and had, you know, tea and coffee together. So, you know, at the working level, at the level of the people, I think there is an excellent working relationship, understanding. Things are moving very well. Somehow at the, you know, level of the media or at some political level, issues are raised. But, you know, I think fundamentally there is really no problem. Of course, some issues, every issue you have to sit and discuss. And eventually, obviously, in each country, there has to be consensus before you can agree and move on. But all I'm trying to say is that, you know, these are important measures that we could take practically and pragmatically, which would really benefit our two countries. So the open border is a great asset. We must continue to keep this border open between our two countries. But at the same time, so in order to maximize the benefits from the open border, but at the same time, we have to minimize the negative fallout of the open border. And hence, regulation is required. And of course, when you're talking about the open border, you know, I should also mention to you that while in 2007, we agreed to about 98% of the border has been resolved. And strip maps, these are little maps that they make for each segment of the border. Those have been initialed at the level of the surveyors of the two countries. They have not been ratified at the political level. 2% of the border, largely pertaining to Kalapani and Narsai Susta, those remain unresolved. And those obviously cannot be resolved at the technical level. They have to be resolved at the political level. Our view has been that most of the problems that happen at the border, encroachment, etc., is by the local people over there. You know, if the land is more fertile somewhere, you want to cultivate it, becomes a big issue. So those sorts of problems can easily be addressed if we ratify the strip maps that have been agreed, 98%. So at least 98% of the border, you'll have no problems. Everybody knows where the border is. So there'll be no dispute. Of course, the other issue is the das gaja, the 10 yards, especially in the Tarai, because that is all encroached on. So at least the policy now is that, you know, you can't do much about what is encroached on because people are living there and it will be a huge law and order problem, but at least no fresh encroachments should take place. And eventually the goal would be to clear the das gaja, though it's easier said than done. Our view is that, look, if 98% we've agreed, let's finalize that. And the remaining 2% we can discuss and try and arrive at a political settlement. But let's not hold up the 98% till the remaining 2% is finalized. You know, I'll tell you, to give you an example of India-China relations. You know, the 62 war was a very humiliating defeat for India, the India-China war. And then our relations went into a cold storage. For a very long time, we said that, you know, the border is the fundamental issue. And unless and until the border issue is resolved, we are not going to move forward on any aspect of our relationship with China. I'm putting it very, very broadly. It's more nuanced. Then Prime Minister Rajiv Gandhi came along in 1986 and said, no. You know, the border issue obviously is the most fundamental issue in the relationship, and we have to carry that forward. But at the same time, we should also continue our relationship in other areas. So we followed that policy, and today, for instance, our bilateral trade with China is $65 billion. You know, India and China work together in so many different areas. So what I'm trying to say is that maybe a policy whereby you don't hold the whole relationship to ransom because of one issue, if you expand your relationship in diverse areas, maybe even that one issue will eventually get resolved in a more positive way. I mean, it's, take India, Pakistan, say the Kashmir question. You know, Pakistan can have the view, no, until Kashmir is resolved, we're not going to do anything. But that's their view, it's possible. But resolution of Kashmir is an issue that is not going to happen overnight. And if you don't want to move forward in the relationship, you know, then that's fine. But if you engage simultaneously on diverse fronts, I think you will benefit. And I think eventually maybe even the difficult political issues, a certain environment and a context may be created in which those difficult issues can also be addressed satisfactorily, you know, to the mutual satisfaction. So, you know, this is the way I feel that, you know, you need to engage on all issues, identify things that can be resolve them, move ahead, while continuing to talk about issues that are more difficult to resolve. But you have to move ahead. Otherwise, you know, you're leaving behind unnecessary issues which can be reopened after 10 years once the situation changes. So much on the border. I think on security, I've already mentioned to you the really good cooperation that we're having. I do want to spend some time also on the economic aspect of our relationship. You know, when we talk about peace, stability, and development in Nepal as being a critical objective for Nepal and also an objective for India. Because, you know, how do you get durable peace and security in your country? How do you get durable stability in your country? Of course, you need a constitution, you need strong institutions, you need multi-party democracy. And those are all works in progress. I think political leadership is grappling with those issues and things are moving on ahead. But at a fundamental level, to have durable peace and stability, you need economic development. That is the only way that a country can really protect its sovereignty and integrity if it is strong internally, if it is strong economically. So obviously, like for India, for Nepal, I think development is the number one priority. Without development, there is no security. Without development, the country is not strong. You are vulnerable to all kinds of pressures, pulls, influences. So I think economic development, absolutely number one priority. I think there is a very clear sense that things have to move on this. And I say, as I said in my opening remarks, that this is a great moment in our bilateral relationship. It's a great moment to strengthen our economic cooperation. And I think with serious political will on both sides, we should be able to do something. So when you talk about development, what are the areas that you can look at? Obviously, you have to look at your comparative advantages. What is Nepal's advantage, you know, in terms of Nepal having to develop? And, you know, I mentioned the sector, the water resources sector, high-value services, whether it is tourism, medical tourism, high-value educational facilities, high-value agriculture, agro-processing. So these are some of the areas where I think there are huge opportunities for Nepal. But I think the biggest opportunity for Nepal, which will probably result in the fastest economic growth and rapid alleviation of poverty, is exploiting the hydropower sector. I mean, Nepal is estimated to have a potential of about 85,000 megawatts, of which they say a commercial potential is about 45,000 megawatts. And, you know, the figures keep changing and keep going up, but say roughly if you say 45,000 megawatts. Installed capacity in Nepal is only about 750 megawatts. And today I was reading in the papers, in the last 8 months of this financial year, or the first 8 months, not a single megawatt of power has been added. So, I mean, it's a pathetic situation that you are sitting on a potential of 45,000 megawatts and your installed capacity is 750 megawatts and you're importing power from a country, your neighbor, which is power deficient. So India has a huge deficiency of power. We need more and more power for our own economic development. Nepal has all the potential, and Nepal is importing power from India. It's an absurd situation. When I go to Biratnagar, the whole Chamber of Commerce met me and they said, you know, we need more power from India. Please get this transmission line repaired as soon as possible. You know, we have 12-hour power cuts. Our industries can't function like this. So it's really an absurd situation. I mean, the question you have to ask is, how come Nepal is in this situation today? After how many, I mean, Nepal has been independent for, you know, I don't know, 200 years. So why has this sector not been developed? I think this is, you're all young people. And you have every right to ask this question. I ask myself also, I mean, I'm aghast each time I look at it and look at the figures and look at the situation. Why? We have been talking about hydropower development and cooperation between India and Nepal for 6 decades, 60 years, even before I was born, and I'm, you know, pretty old now. 1948 is when we started work on the Kosi High Dam, survey work and so on. And I went recently to the Kumbh at Mahakumbh at Chatra, and they were telling me, you know, ye bridge tab bana tha, jab ye us zamane mein, and this power substation was built at that time, all related to the Kosi project. 60 years, nothing has happened. Now the point is, we can go into why nothing has happened. You know, people in Nepal may say it's because of India, people in India may say it's because of Nepal. Of course, I don't think that leads anywhere. I think what we need to do is now at least decide that, look, let's move ahead with some of these projects. But on hydropower, I do want to spend some time, because, you know, it's such an important sector, I think, for Nepal's development. So if you look at the history of India-Nepal cooperation in the hydropower sector, we started off with irrigation projects. So basically irrigation projects such as the Kosi and the Gandak projects and the canals that were constructed. Now the experience in Nepal of those projects was not very positive. And there was a lot of criticism that Nepal was not given a good deal from these projects. So after the mid-1980s, India stopped doing irrigation projects along on the border. If you see, the Kosi project was a project in Nepalese territory, but managed by the Bihar irrigation. And if you see, the Gandak project was on the border itself. So what we then started doing, and by the way, these two projects contributed to about 25% of the irrigated land in Nepal is because of these two projects. So it's an important statistic to remember. I mean, I don't know subsequently how much cultivable land you have added, but because these projects were not considered in Nepal to have really benefited Nepal to the extent that they should have, we decided to do all our irrigation projects downstream of the border. So after the 1980s, most of our irrigation projects are downstream of the border. So they're basically single country projects. So no benefit to Nepal. Projects are downstream of the border. They're benefiting the states of Bihar and Uttar Pradesh. So our focus then wasn't on irrigation projects. Second set of projects were the so-called multi-purpose projects. And these are huge projects. You know, these are storage dams with a lot of pondage and hence displacement. Not easy. So here we had, of course, I mentioned the Kosi High Dam and the Sun Kosi Diversion. There is the Karnali Chisapani, which was mentioned in the address by His Excellency the President of Nepal to Parliament recently, which is a huge project, I think between 10 and 20,000 megawatts. There is the Pancheshwar multi-purpose project. So these are multi-purpose projects. They're complex projects because they have three components. They have irrigation, that is benefit to the farmer. They have flood control, because you store the water so you can regulate the amount of water that you release into the river and hence control floods. And the third, of course, is the power component. So we have been discussing these projects for a long, long time, but nothing has moved. Even the Mahakali Treaty, which was passed in 1996, so now it is 2014. So how many years? You know, 18 years. So nothing much has happened. So multi-purpose projects, what was the problem? The problem was, it was very difficult to make an assessment of how to quantify the benefit of irrigation and flood control. Nepal's view was that India will get the major share of irrigation of water for the farmers, or India will get a major share of the flood control benefit. So the idea was, how do you monetize this benefit and then share it equally between India and Nepal? And then one way of doing it was to say that if India is getting more benefit out of irrigation, then you structure the project in such a way that the cost of the irrigation component is borne by India, not by Nepal. Anyway, these are all very technical issues to be resolved by the working level technical people. And I'm happy to say most of them have been resolved. In the case of the Pancheshwar multi-purpose project, most of these things have been resolved, and we are very hopeful that a joint project authority will be set up soon in Mahendranagar, that the detailed project report will be approved and the project implementation can start. But these are some of the difficulties in the multi-purpose projects. Then finally, see, first you said irrigation, bad experience, multi-purpose projects, very difficult. So then what do you do? So then we said, okay, let us look at run-of-the-river projects. And these are very simple projects. So you just take water from place A and through a diversion tunnel, you divert the water and it goes into the same river in the same country at some other place. And you generate the electricity. So this is like Upper Karnali and Upper Marsiandi and Arunthri and West Sethi, and all these are run-of-the-river projects. So these projects should not be controversial. And I think by and large they're not controversial, though there are still some political groups that say, no, this is not advantageous to Nepal, etc. But I don't think they're very strong, their voices. So these are the ones that I think are most feasible right now. And if you look at the newspapers today, there's a lot of talk about how the project development agreements are likely to be signed very soon between the private Indian promoters of these projects and the Board of Investment, PDAs, so-called PDAs. And I hope very much that this happens. Because, you know, I feel that even if one project gets off the ground, I think the people of Nepal will see for themselves what it means. I think nobody can quite comprehend, you know, they say $1 billion investment, what does it mean? Nobody can, you know, you 10 lakhs, you understand, 1 billion, nobody understands. And, you know, I went to Sankhwa Sabha recently, which is where Arunthri is located, to Khanbari, and there, you know, everybody was saying, why the delay, what's wrong, why is the company not investing more? Everyone, even representatives of political parties, you know, whose headquarters oppose the project, but the people over there were saying, no, what to do, you know, our party line is this, but we think it's a good project. So I'm quite optimistic that things will move forward. So, you know, hydropower, and I think this is really the one area that our two governments need to focus on in a very big way, because, you know, you forget about the politics. Politics is not going to take you anywhere. See, there is a lot of historical baggage in the relationship. But either you go on analyzing that historical baggage and not do anything, or you say, you know, that's a closed chapter, let's move on ahead and, you know, make the best of the situation that we have. So I'm a very practical, pragmatic person, and, you know, you have to look at your own interest, benefit, and move ahead. So there is no point, you know, going into the history, geography, you know, 200 years ago this happened or that happened. It doesn't lead anybody anywhere. So much on, of course, if you have questions on this power agreement and so on, I can. Now, the other area that we are also looking at very closely in Nepal is the development of infrastructure. Is the development of infrastructure, also facilities like health, education. And if you see a lot of our, I'm actually almost at the end of my talk, so just as well you missed it. So you know, I think these areas also we're looking at very closely, and I think these are directly linked to development prospects of Nepal, you know, whether it is development of infrastructure. See, in order to develop your relationship in any sector, you must have the basic groundwork, no? You must have a legal arrangement in place. You must have the physical infrastructure. We all talk about, you know, our trade is this, that, or the other. Now, how do you increase it, say, 10 times if you want to increase it? A, you must have a legal arrangement in place. And in the case of India and Nepal, we have a good legal arrangement in place. You know, we have our trade and transit treaties. We have our double taxation avoidance. Unfortunately, our bilateral investment protection agreement has also got stuck in some political turmoil. Hopefully, that will also get done. Because, you know, no investor is doing charity. If a foreign company is coming to invest in your country, they're coming to make profit. They're not, you know, it's not altruism. We want to, you know, maybe as a government servant, I feel, yeah, we have to develop, you know. But they are interested in making money. And in the process, you will benefit and develop. I mean, that's what capitalism is about. So obviously, if they don't have an assurance that you're going to protect their investment, or, you know, they can take their money out of the country, nobody is going to come. So, you know, the feeling that the whole world is desperately waiting outside to come in to invest here because of the great opportunities is all rubbish. Every country in the world is lobbying very hard to get foreign investment. I was in Vietnam, some years ago. The way every branch of the government of Vietnam, every district official, every time you went to a district, there was huge plans, PowerPoint presentation, this project, that project, this is what we'll do for you, that. That is the way people are lobbying. I don't see that happening in Nepal. So, you know, to assume that the whole world is waiting to come and invest is not the right. You have to go out, find people you think who will be interested in investing, pursue them. Before we opened the electricity market in India, you know, it was so difficult. There was one lady in Enron. I forget her name. She became quite notorious later on. But we had a delegation of our cabinet secretary and 10 secretaries of the government of India who went to Atlanta, where Enron headquarters, they sat outside her office for 2 hours saying we have to meet her. So, you know, you have to make the effort. And when I say make the effort, it's not only getting those people, but also doing things domestically, which will make it attractive for a foreign investor to come into the country. So one is the legal aspect. Hopefully the legal framework, institutional framework will be there. Second, infrastructure. Without infrastructure, it's a pipe dream. You say, you know, I want our bilateral trade to double from 5 billion to 10 billion. It's not going to happen. Unless you have road connectivity, unless you have rail connectivity, unless you have seamless transmission from the ports to the border and so on. You know, we're developing. So we're doing a lot of projects to strengthen this connectivity, especially at the border level. Whether it is, you know, there is the road project in the Tarai, then there is some talk of the North-South fast-track project. We are building 5 rail connections at different points of the border, 4 integrated checkposts. Transmission lines are being built. A 400 kV transmission line is being built between Muzaffarpur and Halkebal. And once that is completed, you should be able to import 1,000 megawatts of power every year from India. Of course, we are hoping that you will also export, but let's see. So this infrastructure has to be put in place. So we are making all this arrangement to ensure that, you know, our economic cooperation can actually progress rapidly. So the idea is that, you know, you have the institutional arrangements, you have the physical infrastructure in place, and then, you know, at least you've created the necessary conditions for an enhancement of your economic cooperation. And all these things are really being fed by either grants, in the case of, you know, say small development projects we do in many places, schools and so on. You'll see in the newspapers every other day some project or the other. Or these are through lines of credit, which are concessional loans. You know, I think we provide about $350 million to Nepal for various projects, power projects, road projects. So there are different, different financial mechanisms through which this sort of cooperation is taking place. But I guess, you know, this is more more the stuff of practical diplomacy. And of course, you know, a whole lot of focus of our assistance program is on health and education, basically, you know, whether it's through creating infrastructure such as the BPK IHS in Dharwan, or of course, hopefully this trauma center will finally be ready in a few months' time. So a lot of these projects, vocational training centers, etc., which have been created. One comment I want to make before I conclude on the SAARC process. You know, SAARC, for various reasons, has really not, has been kind of very sleepy, you know. I know here politicians get very angry when the newspaper says Sust Sarkar. So, you know, our SAARC has been a little sust also. And I think it needs to be shaken up. And I hope under Nepal's leadership and Nepal's chairmanship in November this year, we can actually get SAARC off the ground and not just talk about big things, but actually implement concrete projects on the ground. And our strategy vis-a-vis SAARC is that, look, it's a free world. So if all SAARC countries want to do something together, very good. If all of them don't want to do it, then there should be an opt-out clause. If you don't like something, then okay, let the others do it, you don't do it. So, you know, we should really move forward in that way. You can't allow any one country which has some problem or the other to hold up the whole process which may benefit you know, the other countries that are interested. So SAARC level cooperation, sub-regional cooperation, you know, there are other organizations, BIMSTEC, Nepal is the chair of BIMSTEC, big potential, but you know, so far it's a lot of talk. I find that the ASEAN, for instance, India has a full dialogue partnership with ASEAN, and a lot is happening on that front, and I think we really need to energize SAARC. So with our new government in Delhi, with Nepal in the chair of SAARC, with the SAARC secretariat being led by a Nepalese diplomat, we are confident and very hopeful that you know, new life, SAARC will get a new lease of life. I haven't spoken much about culture and so on, but that's something you all know. And if there are any issues, I've spoken longer than I should normally, you know. Yes. It's difficult for me to speak for more than half an hour, it's almost been an hour. But you know, it's great to see young people who are at the beginning of their careers, and I think there are a lot of expectations, certainly in Nepal, I'm sure there are a lot of expectations from all of you to do well in whatever you choose to do for yourself and your family, but also hopefully contribute something to the country. Thank you.
I'd like to express thankfulness to Your Excellency Ambassador Andre for his really insightful lectures, and thank you very much for lectures. And now I just like to open the floor, and we'll have an interaction with Ambassador Ray. If you have any questions, introduce yourself and ask questions briefly.
Yeah, in this journey, India is well aware that the India needs its neighbor support and needs its neighbor as a partner. And if we talk about the South Asia, and particularly talking about the Nepal, then in people level, there is so much anti-Indian sentiments. And so my question to you is, why there is this sentiment in spite of the Indian India's commitment and the donation in the infrastructure and all those cooperation, why that sentiment is there? And related to this question, that in this changing scenario where India is in journey of rising power, and then there is the charismatic leader Mr. Narendra Modi became the Prime Minister, is Indian decision maker are thinking to change some strategy or adopt some strategy in people level to change image of India?
Come to that, what I do want to say is that why are we interested in Nepal's development? Because we feel that India will not be able to develop, India will not be able to achieve its full potential if the neighboring countries of India also don't develop. So, you know, we feel that all of us have to develop. For each one of us to develop, everybody has to develop. Because any country that is not developing or is prone to conflict or something else happens will hold the other countries back. So I think that's where we are coming from. And you know, it's in our own interest that Nepal develops, that there is peace and stability in Nepal. Because if there is no peace and stability in Nepal, it will affect India adversely and obviously impact on our development. So I, you know, that point I should have made. But I want to. Now on this anti-Indian sentiment, actually, you know, you should tell me, because I have been, you know, I used to come to Nepal, I think 15, 17 years ago. I think the situation has changed. You know, you see, I mean, to be very frank with you, every country has to define itself and decide its own national identity. So what is it that makes you a Nepali? What does Nepali nationalism mean? I think you have to ask yourself that question. Should it be defined in negative way? Should it be defined in terms of positive attributes? So I think that's a question that all of you, all educated young Nepali people, you have to ask yourselves. There are two sides to every issue. If there is an image problem that India has in Nepal, maybe partly because of something that India has done, maybe partly is because something that Nepal has done. So there could be two sides, and you need to examine this in great detail. In India, there is no anti-Nepali sentiment at all. You know, I come from India, I know lots of Nepalese, none at all. In Nepal, there is. And, you know, I can go into my understanding of the historical, you know, in some sense, it's related to the political changes in your country and the type of governments that you had, the type of political leadership that you had. There are many reasons. And maybe there is a perception, you know, many people, journalists ask me, oh, you know, India micromanages everything in Nepal, which is ridiculous. There seems to be a sense that, you know, somehow there is an Indian hand behind. You know, in India, we used to also say at one time, foreign hand, invisible hand, everything was, you know, attributed to some foreign hand. So I'm sorry, I'll be very blunt with you, this is just an excuse. So anybody who is talking about all this is just an excuse. So, you know, I really, you know, you're a self-confident, proud nation. So I don't think anybody can play with your destiny. Your destiny is in your own hands. You have to decide what has to be done. And if people tell you, oh, it's India is doing something or China is not doing something, you know, those are just excuses, as far as I can see. But, you know, this is a very sensitive issue, so I don't want to, you know, you'll all start throwing brickbats at me maybe. it's complicated, and you should really look at this. Why is there this perception?
The query is Nepal and India are a very close neighbor? Neighbor is one for other. It's a very simple topic. And in order to keep maintain good relationship between neighbor country, we have treaties, agreements, and so on, just to set guidelines for doing collaboration and co-work. But whenever we have a treaty between India and Nepal, there used to be debate of some sort of debate on either maybe some right track or some wrong track. And for my, as a student, treaties and those agreements are done to set rules, just for the mutual benefits, not for anyone's loss, not for anyone's defeat. So going back to the future, we have so many agreements and treaties. Is there any places, is there any instances that we can review for once treaties and agreements then once we have, so that we can make some review, if needed, we can do some review upon them, so that we can build up, both countries can build up some proper confidence for better further co-work and cooperation. Thank you.
If one person doesn't want and the other wants, there'll be no relationship. So both sides have to agree. So if one side has a problem with something, the other side must sit down and discuss the matter. You know, if you even within a family, husband and wife are quarreling, then unless you sit and discuss and resolve it, you will head for a divorce. So even in a treaty, after all, there are two signatories to a treaty. So if one side has a big problem, I mean, you take any treaty, I may say it's very good, you may say it's not very good, then you must sit and discuss. So our stated position on, you know, say the 1950 treaty, if the Nepali side is unhappy with it and wants it to be amended, modified, then we are prepared to discuss. We have established a mechanism at the level of the foreign secretaries of the two countries. So you please come to us with whatever the problems are, with whatever amendments, etc. you need, and we are prepared to discuss it. But I must say that any agreement that you finalize has to be mutually acceptable to both sides. So there should be something in it for both countries. You can't just cherry pick and say, you know, this benefits me, so I take it. And, you know, since this doesn't benefit me, I don't take it. Then there'll be no agreement. So your point is valid. If there is a sense that certain treaties, historical treaties, are unequal or, you know, not desirable, they should be amended, we are prepared to look at it and discuss it.
My question is, although you mentioned that politics is not going to take us anywhere, but it's just my small query. I mean, editor of Kantipur Daily was here on February 20th. He also wrote a book, Prayogshala. In his book, he has mentioned that it is not my, reflection. I mean, I read that book and it's my just parallel comparison, mentioning your idea and his idea. As you mentioned that India's prime objective, foreign policy objective towards Nepal is peace, stability, prosperity. But reading his book or some other's book, recently even of Prashant Jha, they have mentioned in their book that India usually fund Nepal through intelligence unit, particularly RAW, and it is that place where Nepalese leaders compromise. And so, as you said, peace, stability, and prosperity, but here our senior journalists, even scholars, great scholars, are mentioning these things. So we, as a student, we are confused. I mean, what actually is just, it's the question. I'm a student, so I just want to know from your reflection on these two things. So, they have even given the examples cited from different, you know, when Nepal was the first CA dissolved, Mr. Tripathi was here. They have even cited the name of Tripathi and Anil Sinha. So as a student, so I expect that if you could just resolve this paradoxical mindset of ours, that's also. Thank you.
Everybody is micromanaging. All your newspapers say, oh, the Nepal policy is left to bureaucrats and intelligence agencies. It should really be dealt with at a political level. But you know, this is a misunderstanding of the way the Indian system works. In India, the broad policy is set at the political level. What is our overall view of India-Nepal relationship? You know, what is that, as I said, peace, stability, etc. It is then the job of the implementers of policy to try and fill this with concrete projects, proposals, schemes, plans, strategies, initiatives. And in Government of India, decision making is a collective decision making. It's not that only MEA, External Affairs, makes a decision, or it's only RAW, or only the intelligence, or only the army. It's a collective decision making process. So the structure that we have is that it's no one organization. And it's not that every organization has the same view on an issue. In any country, you have different organizations, all engaged vis-a-vis, say, Nepal, or some aspect of the relationship with Nepal. So when you're developing an overall policy, you have to factor in the views of all the organizations. So it is through discussion that you evolve a consensus, and that is the policy that you then try and implement. Now, this Prayogshala, I'm waiting for the English edition. Sudhir Sharma told me that he's coming out with, so I'll read it carefully. I haven't read it, but Prashant Jha's book I've read. And, you know, in any diplomatic, what is diplomacy? It's meeting people, talking to them, trying to persuade them to your point of view. There is nothing else that you have So basically, you know, what is my job? I meet everybody here, I, you know, discuss things with them, talk to them. So it depends on how you look. You know, it's not intervention, it's not micromanagement, it's not. And then why be micromanaged? If somebody is saying do this, you say no, I won't do it, finish. So, you know, it's, what I'm trying to say is sometimes, you know, all this makes for good news stories and so on, and maybe there is even some truth in some of these things. But a lot of the time, there's a big, you know, you create a big superstructure where, you know, over nothing. And I don't think it's fair to say that X did this or Y did that. Anybody who's working here is working in the context of an overall policy of the government of India. Nobody is doing things on their own, and if they're doing something only for on themselves or their own benefit, then obviously that then they're not fulfilling the duties that they're supposed to do.
So what can Nepal learn from Indian federal practices? Is it true that our two neighbors, China and more prominently India, are against Nepal being transformed itself to a federal state?
A federal model. No, this is something for the people of Nepal to decide. Who are we to say? I mean, in India we have followed a certain model. It's a hybrid. We started off with linguistic states and we had the same debates, you know, about integrity, this, that and the other. But the model worked quite well. Since then we have now graduated to some type of administrative things, like, you know, Bihar was, Jharkhand came out, and from Madhya Pradesh, Chhattisgarh came out, and from UP now they are talking about breaking it up into, Uttarakhand came out, then they are talking about three, four more states. So now they are not linguistic, everybody speaks the same language. So you have to decide what is suitable for Nepal. As far as I am concerned, our view is that federalism has been accepted by your interim constitution. So, you know, we don't have any. But our goal in Nepal is to see stability in the country. And you will have stability in the country if every section of society has a stake in the constitution that is being drafted. If some groups in your society feel neglected or marginalized, then you might be sowing seeds for discontent in the future. That's as far as I will go on this. I don't want to say anything more, but this is something that the people of Nepal and the Constituent Assembly have to decide for themselves. I don't think foreign countries have any say or choice or preference. Certainly we in India, we don't have any preference in terms of how you go about defining your federalism, other than to say that all groups should be accommodated.
I have two small curiosities. The first curiosity is, what may be the practical way or regional policy of India for collective security and integrated development of SAARC region and SAARC headquarters shifting issues? And my second curiosity is that how India will resolve those some sort of issues regarding border management with her neighboring countries of SAARC region. Because unless resolving such types of problem, it may be a bit more difficult to be immersed as global or superpower for India in contemporary old world.
Resolution of these issues will take time. It doesn't mean that you don't do any other cooperation with those countries because you have a border issue. So certainly border issue has primacy, must be addressed. But at the same time, you must continue to cooperate also. Otherwise, you're harming yourself. You're neither resolving the border issue, nor are you cooperating. So you're stuck in a stalemate. And what was the first?
Collective
security. SAARC is not about collective security. SAARC is about economic cooperation. It was very clear when SAARC was established that because there are political differences between the member states of SAARC, best to leave those issues out. If you bring those issues into SAARC, then you can forget about cooperation. Then we'll only be discussing all the bilateral political issues that we have. So when SAARC was conceived, it was really as a model for economic cooperation, that political issues you discuss bilaterally and economic issues you discuss within SAARC. As far as SAARC headquarters, see, this whole thing is, in fact, one newspaper even wrote an editorial on it. So what our Minister of State for Home Affairs was saying is there is something called a SAARC Disaster Response Center or something, which is located in Delhi, and a new building is being set up for that. So maybe, you know, he was either misquoted or he may have made a mistake himself. But certainly there's no proposal to shift the SAARC headquarters. It's very nicely located in Thamel in Kathmandu. So I don't think there's any proposal. And editorial comment. It's a bit much.
Who are really inquisitive, and what I would like to share with our distinguished guest today is that most of our students are from diverse academic background. This is an interdisciplinary subject. So some of them are microbiologists, some of them are engineers, those who raise the questions, and some of them are computer scientists. So because of their background, they are just learning something in this first semester. So their perception, their theoretical background has yet to be developed on social science discourses. So hopefully they did. This is the, fortunately, this is the last and the most important guest lecture in this semester, and the semester is almost at the end, and they have enjoyed quite a lot with the lectures by Your Excellency. I would like to express my thankfulness and my department thankfulness to all participants and distinguished guests, and especially Your Excellency Ambassador Ranjit Ray. And we will be anticipating to have collaboration and then further participation of Indian scholars and Indian envoys here in Kathmandu. And as Ambassador Simkara has pertinently raised that, we do lack such platform where we can discuss the foreign policy issues in this country. So we are trying our level best to make this small endeavor to extend it as a kind of like a platform where we can discuss our issues, bilateral, trilateral, and then multilateral issues of foreign policy and diplomacy in the days to come, so that we are anticipating work together with Your Excellencies and Indian University and Research Institute in the days to come. And thank you very much, and at the end, we are almost running out of time, so I would like to request our chief guest, Rector of the University, Professor Gunidhi Nepane, to deliver his concluding remarks, and will be over the guest lecture session today after Professor Gunidhi Nepane's Rector's concluding remarks. Thank you very much once again.
Excellency, Ambassador of India to Nepal, Mr. Ranjit Ray, coordinator of the MIRD program, former ambassador, faculties, students, ladies and gentlemen. It is a great pleasure for me to be here this evening to share a few things with you. As I know, you have been delighted with the very good lecture of His Excellency, Ambassador of India, in different issues, including peace, stability, and development, how Nepal is passing through, and how India is cooperating to Nepal. I would like to thank His Excellency Ranjit Ray for accepting our invitation to deliver his speech on foreign policy of India. I believe His Excellency's speech will be a great source of inspiration for our students to understand the foreign policy of India. Foreign policy and diplomacy are quite important phenomena to protect independent countries' national interests, particularly a country like ours. In order to formulate visionary policies, in depth research and studies is required. Realizing the inadequacy in understanding the varieties and complexities of contemporary international relations and diplomacy, Tiruvan University has recently launched master degree program in international relations and diplomacy. The objectives of the program is to contribute Nepal by producing skilled human resources in international relations and diplomacy. MIRD is expected to develop as an academic platform for academicians and practitioners working in the field of international relations, foreign policy and diplomacy. Among other attributes, this program has been hosting the guest lectures from renowned academicians, diplomats, politicians, among others. The MIRD has also planned to send students for internships in government agencies, NGOs, INGOs, and diplomatic missions. Similarly, the department has planned to operate a student exchange program with reputed universities, research institutions, and specialized training institutions in India and elsewhere. His Excellency and ladies and gentlemen, Nepal-India relations is a special due to their geographical and cultural proximity, so that introducing with the foreign policy of India will be of great useful to our graduate students. Therefore, we are looking forward to work with the universities and research institutes in India which focus their researches on international relations and diplomacy. Once again, I express my sincere thanks to His Excellency Ambassador Mr. Ranjit Ray and you all for all of your efforts to make this program successful. Thank you very much. Thank you.